Hey, it's Dr. Amanda with Straight Smile Solutions, straightsmilesolutions.com, and today we're going to talk about craniofacial teams. This is the infographic I could find. I didn't want to put a patient on there that had craniofacial needs, but let's talk all about that. What is a craniofacial team? When should you refer to a craniofacial team for ortho instead of keeping it in-house? Where are they? What are they? Things like that. How do you know if you need one? And what's the benefit? So I first became acquainted with craniofacial teams when I was a student at UCSF in San Francisco. They had a craniofacial team. I volunteered there once a week for a year or two before I went to ortho residency, and it was absolutely fascinating for me. It was something I didn't know existed. So at UCSF, our craniofacial team, granted this was over 20 years ago, was composed of all different kinds of specialists that met once a week for I think a full day to see patients with all their needs. So there was like a plastic surgeon, there was an audiologist, I believe there was an ophthalmologist, there was definitely a pediatric dentist, there was an orthodontist, and pretty definitely an OMFS, an oral myofacial surgeon. I almost said OMT. Maybe there's that too now. But pretty much just about everyone who would need to be in charge of making sure a child that had a defect, a syndrome, or some type of growth issue with their head, face, mouth, was taken care of. Quite often these patients are syndromic patients or they have genetic issues. It could be as simple, and I say simple because that's not simple, as something like clefting, cleft lip, cleft palate, all the way into various very complicated syndromes which present with lots of different facial issues, and orthodontic issues. I know sometimes you see patients in your office and you're like, they look kind of funny, kind of asymmetric, but their teeth don't look that hard, it doesn't look that hard for me to fix. Well, you don't want to take their dental issues. You don't want to treat their dentistry necessarily, because it's probably a heck of a lot more complicated than you think. The bone often is different. If you see all kinds of asymmetries in their jaw and in their bite, you don't want to go there for many different reasons. A, it's going to be much more difficult than you think. B, they often have special needs and they need special, a lot of sensory needs, other things. They need special kind of TLC, special kind of care. I'm saying this in the nicest way I can, but C, if you start messing with it and you screw up, you basically messing up with this patient permanently. And you're affecting this patient from getting the need later that is often fully covered by medical insurance. These craniofacial teams know how to use medical insurance to get the patient everything they need. So for example, if you start moving the teeth, the jaws and the asymmetry in the face might get worse. The patient may have more difficulty speaking, functioning, eating, biting. And now you've permanently damaged this patient just because you wanted to try to help. So you're trying to be helpful, but you're actually hurting the patient. So that's why sometimes when I work with some of my doctors in my consulting practice at Straight Smile Solutions, I go, hey, pump the brakes. I know you're thinking this isn't hard, but it's a million times harder than you think it is. Don't touch this patient. Refer this patient to a craniofacial team for treatment. Now, most of the craniofacial teams that I'm familiar with are at children's hospitals or dental schools that have multidisciplinary residencies. But there are some private craniofacial clinics that are out there too, as well. You can give them lots of options. The best thing you can do for your patient is not touch them, even if they want you to. Refer them out. Perhaps they will come back to you and say, it's okay for you to treat this patient. And that's great, if that's what they say. But I would rather you be safe than sorry, because if you start messing with their bite, their teeth, like I said, you could make their needs so much worse and you could really damage them. And you could also affect their ability to get the surgeries that they need later. And maybe it's not surgeries, maybe it's just ortho, but just refer them out if you need to. It's the right thing to do. Even a lot of orthodontists refer to craniofacial. I certainly did a lot of times because my offices were just not equipped to meet the full needs of these patients, as needed, even though I had experience, because I knew that as I moved the teeth, other issues were gonna come up. It might affect their hearing, their bite, their ability to eat, chew, and swallow. Also, a lot of these patients have sensory issues and they need things done a certain special way. And the team will be able to address these issues and affect the orthodontics in a way, or guide the orthodontics in a way that's best for this patient's special needs. And you may not be prepared for that. So that's what craniofacial team is. And you'd be surprised how many times everything is fully covered. Why charge this patient when it's possible they could get everything covered for free? Because they have some special needs. Now, it is a very, this is where the difficult issue comes up. And I'm going to give you my scripting on how I've handled it. First of all, of course, I'm looking at the medical history. Have they listed any things on there that, you know, syndromes, other things? I mean, if they're not marking anything. And I suspect this patient's a craniofacial patient. And by the way, a lot of times spectrum or autism spectrum disorders, they fall within craniofacial issues. And I don't know which comes first, the chicken or the egg, but I suspect there's definitely a correlation because I see a lot of that. So, they may have listed, spectrum disorder, autism or whatever, Asperger's on the medical history, but that's just part of it. You know what I mean? There's probably something else. It's possible that maybe they're just not telling you. Maybe the patient doesn't know. Maybe the parents don't even know. Maybe they just think the patient is normal. They don't even realize that there's an issue. So this is how I generally set it. And depending on the age of the patient, I will either have the patient in the room or take the parent aside. And I don't think I've ever had a parent get upset before. It depends on how you handle it. I mean, obviously you want to get the patient away from other, or the parent away from other parents, other patients, take them in a consult room. Say, hey, I just want to talk to you. I have a few concerns, done some measurements. I've noticed that little Johnny has a little bit of asymmetry. Some things are a little unbalanced in his face. Orthodontics definitely can help with some of these, but sometimes it's outside the scope of what an orthodontist can do. I don't feel that comfortable treating him here right at the moment, without him seeing a specialist first to see if this is the right thing to do, because I don't want to make certain things worse, and I'm concerned and I'm sensitive to this. So I'm going to ask you to go to visit a craniofacial team. And then what you can do is you can go ahead and contact them, help them set up the appointment. That's the best thing you can do, because often these are at dental schools. And, there's a lot of hoops to being seen at a dental school or a hospital, making sure that patient gets scheduled, making sure that you get a copy of the records that you've taken. You could definitely take records and send those ahead of time. That is the best thing you can do, because sometimes they're going to see the records and be like, yeah, definitely we want to see little Johnny in here. Or they might say, nah, it's okay. It's not something we do here. Help them set up the appointment, send the records ahead of time. Help advocate for your patient. You don't want to just abandon them. Hey, here's a referral, bye. That's not the right thing to do. Help advocate for your patient and then give them a buzz in a month or two and follow up, because it's possible that maybe it's fine, and they're like, yeah, cool, you can still see them in your practice. But 9 times out of 10, when I've done this, they were in the right spot. I did the right thing and they stayed there and they were well taken care of. So, and like I said, a lot of them could be fully covered by medical insurance, by state-funded insurances, depending on what type of needs the patient has. So you really are helping the patient get all the care that they need. So you're doing the right thing. All right, thanks so much.